Hey, welcome everybody. So I get to really get in here and get after this again for a second time. And I've got somebody really awesome in tow with me. So how's it going, sir?
What's up, Raquan? I'm good. How are you?
Good. This is our first time working together. So this should be a lot of fun.
Yeah, we have another edition of CFB Pro Showdown this month with Luis being the end boss. If you guys read Twitter, there's a great picture with Luis being the end boss in one of the tweets from the CFB Twitter. So definitely make sure to check that out.
All right, well, let's dive right in here. Looks like, well, we got a couple of blue based decks, not a surprise. I expect we're gonna see a lot of that today.
Oh yeah. It looks like we're starting with a gross spiral mirror. And both players seem to be on Temur Reclamation by the looks of it, which obviously is, I think, the best deck in Standard. By now, there has been so many tournaments, so many results. It feels like we have been playing pretty much the same Standard format for a really long time. And just judging by the results, I think it's pretty easy to say that Temur Reclamation is the best deck in the format.
Yeah, it's really hard to argue that. And looks like neither one of them is going to be missing land drops here, at least through the first four turns. So let's see what happens.
Yeah, so this matchup, game one, is usually more about the combo. It's about, you know, resolving with that reclamation, going for the combo kill with a big expansion explosion when it can get to a lot of mana. And usually game one, both players have a few death cards in their deck. You know, maybe that Scorching Dragonfire that we already see in Wolti's hand. That's usually not a card that you want to draw in the Temur mirror. You can still use it to get rid of Uro. You know, when turn three your opponent plays Uro from their hand, it's going to get sacrificed. You can respond to the trigger by playing Scorching Dragonfire on it, and the clause saying that the creature would die gets exiled. At least it applies there, so it can completely get rid of Uro before it can even get escape back. But otherwise, cards like Scorching Dragonfire, you know, cards like Storm's Wrath, that's not the kind of stuff that you want to draw in game one in these Temur mirrors.
Yeah, and have you seen these decks morph to playing fewer of those cards since the format's become more reclamation mirrors?
Yeah, I think one thing that I've been seeing is Aethergust kind of replacing these red damage burn spells, because it's a thing that can also deal with some of the creatures from, you know, the Ragnar Sacrifice deck, for example, has cards like Dreadhorde Butcher. There is a lot of mono green now. It's one of the more popular aggro decks. You can use Aethergust to deal with cards like Questing Beast. So yeah, I think lately a lot of these red burn spells have been replaced by Aethergust and Brazen Borrower, even though they're slightly worse against the aggro decks. The advantage is that you can use them in these Temur mirrors and have them actually be relevant cards. Like being able to use either Gust on your opponent's Wilderness Reclamation can be the difference between, you know, winning and losing the game.
Yeah, and a card like Aethergust is actually reasonable, because one of the non-reclamation decks you're going to run into is sometimes just like mono green still being popular, right? And it works against that as well.
Yeah. We see a lot of counter magic in Wolti's hand. There's a Mystic Dispute, which I think is also kind of standard these days. You want to give yourself something to be able to counter Teferi, which is one of the ways that your deck can get in a lot of trouble. And we also see Sublime Epiphany, which is a new card from M21. And I have to say, I'm still not convinced. You know, it's obviously, you know, a lot of value. You get to draw a card, you get to make a copy of something, bounce something, you know, all the modes. But it's a 6-mana card in a format that where people play Mystica Dispute main. I'm not sure if that's the kind of expensive spell that I want to play. Like I think the flash threats, obviously, you know, Nightback Ambusher, Shark Typhoon. That's the stuff that I like to do when I have a lot of mana. But Sublime Epiphany, it's like high risk, high reward. If it gets countered by Mystic Dispute, you'd never like to see that. But if it resolves, that's a lot of value.
Well, it looked like we were debating fighting over that last Dragonfire there, but let it go to get the Wilderness Reclamation into play. And now we're going to be fighting over this Reclamation, though there's not much of a fight. We're just going to Aethergust it back to the top.
Yeah, that's kind of like how you can win game one sometimes pretty easily when you when you're the one who gets to resolve Wilderness Reclamation, because then cards like Mystic Dispute kind of lose most of their value. Now you're working with a lot of mana, so right now Ginnon in a little bit of an advantage position with that Wilderness Reclamation in play, especially now picking up that copy of Expansion Explosion. But yeah, Wolti also able to resolve theirs.
Yeah, and so this is about to get real interesting. So yeah, we're looking at, do we try to cast? I guess here we're just going to Shark Typhoon. Nope, not even going to do that. We're just going to scry some cards, it looks like.
All right, yeah, now you have the option between scrying or making a big Shark Typhoon token. And I like to be proactive. I like to, you know, cycle the shark, try to put some pressure on my opponent. But it looks like both players have some pretty reasonable stuff to work with. And they're just valuing trying to have access to more interactive cards. So maybe, you know, more counter spells to make sure that your opponent cannot resolve like an Expansion Explosion, which at this point would be kind of game ending, because if you're able to like draw seven new cards, that pretty much means that you will be able to, you know, find more counters and eventually make sure that your opponent's explosion never resolves.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, here it looks like Wolti is probably just deciding if they want to spin that Mystical Dispute yet to protect an Uro. But I guess if it just goes to the graveyard, you just let it try to get it back later.
Yeah, that was an important other gust, because getting Uro in play is also one of the ways you can get ahead really quickly. And yeah, that other gust was really important, because not only do you, you know, stop Uro from coming into play, there was also five cards that got exiled from the graveyard, so it's going to be harder to bring it back again. Wolti a little bit short on lands, only five mana in play right now, which was a little bit unfortunate for them, because, you know, you don't get to play as big explosions. It's harder to play around cards like Mystic Dispute. Your opponent can cycle bigger Shark Typhoons. So obviously not a great situation, but at least there's still a reclamation in place. You get to work with twice as much mana.
Nope. Are we going to get to see the big spell here? We are. So there's your Sublime Epiphany. We'll get to see if it matters here.
So Bouncer Reclamation, deny you the token from Shark Typhoon, and now obviously you have two different triggers. If you really wanted, you could stop your opponent from drawing the card with the Stifle trigger, but obviously here countering the 5/5 is probably a better idea. So overall, yeah, Sublime Epiphany looked pretty good in this situation. And wow, Dispute still being able to be used here on that.
Yeah, but that Dispute held on for a couple of turns there and actually came in big.
All right, now it's an interesting situation. Both players with a couple cards in hand. Do you go for the Expansion Explosion? Would you rather try to bring back Uro from the graveyard? What is the play here?
Yeah, interestingly, both players have their reclamations out, and both players are holding Expansion Explosions here.
Yeah, now it's going to be like a situation like who blinks first, or I guess neither player obviously knows that the other player doesn't have a counter. It, you know, we have access to both players' hands, but if you're sitting out there, you're obviously thinking, well, what if there's another Mystic Dispute? You know, what if there's another Aether Gust? Then I tap out, then I let my opponent resolve their Expansion Explosion. So now it's going to be an interesting game of sort of who blinks first or who decides to go for it, I guess.
It looks like we're going to go ahead and probably Petty Theft this Uro. Actually, hesitated. Looked like we were going to go for it. Looked like Kanan was thinking about it and then changed our mind.
I think the situation was that you naturally have a stop at the end of your opponent's turn, but if Kanan had the stop at the end of Volti's second main phase, Ginnon would have been able to bounce the Wilderness Reclamation while Wolti was tapped out, and that would have allowed Kinnan to kind of work with, you know, a lot of mana next turn while the opponent would have been tapped out, because the reclamation would have never triggered. There wouldn't be enough mana for the reclamation to be replayed, because everything was tapped out, and there wouldn't be the trigger because the rec would get bounced before the end of turn happened. So I think that was a situation where you could have kind of used a better timing to give yourself sort of a free turn of resolving that expansion explosion. You would have been able to target the Ura with it if you wanted to get it off the battlefield. And I think that would have been a really, really big swing. Although we know that Wolti would just untap and replay their reclamation and play their own expansion explosion. Mm-hmm. So this is still a really, really interesting game.
Yeah, and that's one thing it feels like, that the reclamation mirrors are very skill intensive. I just think, you know, some players struggle with just having to deal with all those mirror matches when you're trying to climb the arena ladder these days.
Yeah, the mirror is definitely not easy, and like it's a lot of, you know, the right sequencing, and sometimes it's just about setting the right stops. And I remember that when I first started playing Reclamation, I would accidentally pass so many turns where I intended to, you know, do something big at the end of my turn with all the triggers, but I just forgot to set a stop at the end of my turn. So yeah, there's a lot of these little things that you need to do, and sometimes it involves setting a stop at the end of your opponent's second main phase just to be able to time your Petty Theft a little better.
All right, so we're seeing the second wolf of the match here, or at least of this game.
Nightpack Ambusher can be like kind of a hit or miss. Early on, it's really, really strong. But later in the game, it can be an awkward draw, especially if your opponent has access to a lot of mana and Shark Typhoon, because sometimes you can't even really afford to attack with the Ambusher because your opponent would be able to make a bigger shark and just eat your wolf for free. And also, you know, the wolves are obviously just ground creatures, so they can block the flyers. So if it comes to this late point in the game, you are in an awkward position with the ambushers just not being able to do all that much. But if you're able to resolve it early, you know, turn three or turn four, it can definitely just completely win you the game.
Last turn, it looked like Wolti, did they just accidentally blow up their own blast zone there?
It's possible.
Yeah, because it looked like the blast zone got blown up to remove nothing. I'm not really sure what happened. I was trying to process, like, did I miss something? But, like, no, everything's still there. So, kind of strange. Might have been a misclick.
Yeah, that is obviously unfortunate. So, Wolti goes for a little bit of card draw, hoping to draw into something like Negate to be able to counter Kinnan's possible expansion explosion. Doesn't find it.
All right, we're setting up the QQ here. And you do have Mystical Dispute backup, so this is actually a pretty good time, with your opponent only having two mana open, to try to get this expansion explosion off. And all right, for doing it all but one, it looks like, which makes sense. So Wolti's going to opt, and I'm assuming looking for some type of counter magic here, though does find a second Wilderness Reclamation. At least we also found a Reclamation on the other side, so this is interesting.
All right, that's 3, 4, 7, 8 lands. It's going to be 16, 19 mana, 20 mana to work with for Wolti this turn.
And we're going to go ahead and put that Uro back in. And then we're going to be looking at two reclamation triggers. So it's just a matter of, do we want to spend all the mana now or just wait? Do you have enough strategy to just outright finish the game here? But looks like we're just going to go for it now, putting all the mana in the pool, going for a big explosion.
All right, so your
effectively tapped out, so you just go for it here.
Right, yeah. I guess the idea here is you want to play it for as much as you can while possibly holding or leaving up three more mana to pay for Mystic Dispute and to try to draw into something like a Negate or maybe either Gust that is going to deny another expansion explosion from your opponent. But there has been, there are just infinite lands in Kinnan's hand.
Oh,
that,
yeah.
That explosion just, yeah, that's unfortunate. Like, all of these are just also regular lands. Like, none of that stuff is like a Triumph that can be cycled or, you know, or at least some of the utility lands. Maybe like a Blast Zone, you would be able to try to, you know, destroy the two Wilderness Reclamations from your opponent and at least sort of level the field again. Yeah, that is really unfortunate.
And conversely, you know, Wolti did draw both an Aether Gust and a Negate.
That's going to be pretty huge here. We're all getting gusted. Now, Kitten obviously needs to check their graveyard, see how many cards are there. Is it worth it to keep the Uro? You know, try to bring it back again next turn. Do I still have time to do it? If I leave Uro back on the top, my plan is obviously to scry a lot with Castle Vantress. So if I'm keeping the Uro on top, do I really want it there? Or do I just prefer to see more cards off of the castle?
Yeah, and the tough part here is Kanan really has no other action. I mean, at best, you could play the other Wilderness Reclamation next turn, but you don't even have anything to cast with it.
Yeah, all those lands are just... Yeah, just kind of an unfortunate timing. Yeah, and the Uro actually did get put on the top, back on the bottom. So yeah, that was an awkward situation as well. And now it looks like Wolti is in the driver's seat. They're going to be able to resolve that Uro. There's two reclamations still. There's a negate as sort of a like an insurance against, you know, an expansion explosion to make sure that I'm not dying next turn. There's a huge chart.
You did mention you like being proactive. So in these type of situations where you have this much mana, when you're looking at a Shark Typhoon, are you looking more to play it just as an enchantment, or do you rather just make a big 8-8, 12-12 shark?
I think usually I tend to look at my opponent's deck list first. Like if they have four Brazen Borrowers, for example, I'm more inclined to try to play it here to just make a lot of smaller tokens rather than one big one. Because if I just make one big one, they can bounce it and that can get awkward. If they don't have any Brazen Borrowers, for example, I would be a lot more inclined to just cycle Shark Typhoon here to try to deal lethal damage next turn. You know, just try to press the advantage that I already have. I have that negate in my hand. I have Uro that resolved. I am going to attack next turn for a lot of damage. Clearly, my opponent, they drew a lot of cards with expansion, but then they with explosion, but then they didn't really do anything next turn. So I guess it's pretty likely that they either drew a bunch of bad cards like lands, or maybe they drew like Nightback Ambushers or something that is just, you know, not being very useful in this situation. So I just want to try to press the advantage, and I just want to make sure the game ends basically next turn if possible. This is exactly the situation where you get to Scorching Dragonfire the Uro.
Yeah.
That got played from the hand, but yeah, Kinnan sees the writing on the wall and just decide to concede.
Yeah, it's hard to do much against a 15-15 shark.
Yeah, especially while being so flooded. So that was a little bit unfortunate, but sometimes that's how it goes. There is 28 lands, 29, sometimes 30 in the Temur deck, so sometimes this can happen.
And in this matchup, are you looking to sideboard into just more counter magic and just play the long game? Or are you looking to like maybe sneak a few creatures in and come in underneath?
My plan in these matchups is always try to play the flash game. You know, you never really want to tap out because after sideboard, both players are going to have a lot of counter spells. All these Mystical Disputes are coming in, you know, negates, either gusts. all that stuff. So if you ever try to, you know, resolve a wilderness reclamation, for example, on, you know, on turn four or five with like a dispute backup, it's very likely you're going to lose the counter war, and then your opponent's going to be able to untap, play their own reclamation, at which point you're in a really bad position because now your mystical disputes are a lot worse. They have a lot of mana. They are working with twice as much mana as you, so it's so much easier for them to double spell, make bigger Shark Typhoon tokens. And yeah, basically just never want to tap out. I even board out like a copy or two of Uro because you can't even tap out a 4-8 on turn 3. It's just going to get disputed, and then your opponent resolves a Wilderness Reclamation. So it can get super awkward. And yeah, I just want to play all these, you know, Night Pack Ambushers, Shark Typhoon, Brazen Borrower, and just play the flash game while sitting on counter spells and sitting on these disputes and negates and other gusts and all kind of counters that you may have. I'm a little surprised that the fourth copy of Dispute didn't make it into Wolti's deck. Also that Sublime Epiphany got kept in the main deck. That is an awkward card against, you know, Negate and Dispute specifically.
All right, well, we get an opener that's got some counter magic and one of those Uros we were talking about.
I still like to leave like two Uros in the deck because it's still a good card to have access to like at some point in the game, but it's not a card that I want to draw in my opening hand. You can have it on the play sometimes, but even then, like, imagine your turn three on the play is Uro while your opponent has two lands up and they just go Grow Spiral, Wilderness Reclamation, and you're just, you know, the game gets into a really, really hard spot for you. Looks like both players open up on a lot of counters. So this is gonna be one of those games, I think, where basically both players are gonna be passing. Nobody will really want to tap out, and then at some point somebody's gonna find, you know, the Shark Typhoons and Night Pack Ambushers, and they're gonna try to protect the flash threat with the counter spells.
Yeah, it feels like we've reached the point in the format where, you know, each of these reclamation decks are maybe within five cards of each other a lot of the times. So I would expect they're going to have a lot of the same sideboard strategies.
Yeah, this is... Do you see this exact spot? Both players have Uro in their hand, and neither player can afford to tap out for it, which is really strange, right? Because that's... Like, you want to use it to ramp. That's why it's in your deck. But neither player can afford to do it on turn three. So this is the reason why I prefer to board a few of those copies out, because then it gets so awkward when you can't even do, you know, what the card is supposed to do.
Yeah, and I found that interesting that Kinnan didn't play an additional land before trying to cast the Uro to protect it with their mystical dispute.
All right. Luckily for Kinnan, there was no reclamation.
Kinnan did get punished though, because there wasn't a wilderness reclamation there.
Yeah, that was really, really big. Like no reclamation. No, you know, some players are playing Nissa in their deck these days. And Jor-El is interesting. That's also one of the new M21 cards. You can obviously just, you know, build your whole game plan around just resolving it on turn two, and then, you know, naturally making a 2/2 token on each of your next turns, because your deck is so good at drawing those extra cards with the cards that you already have in your deck. You don't really have to, you know, change your build. You naturally already have Opt, you have Growth Spiral, you have Uro, you have, you know, Shark Typhoon. So you're drawing a lot of extra cards from all the cards you're already playing. So sometimes you just play Jor-El on turn two and then just make a token every single turn while spending no additional resources, but it can also be awkward. Like sometimes you just play Jor-El, you have to tap out for it. Your opponent goes end of turn spiral into reclamation, and it can end up being a liability. And it also just forces you to do things on your own turn, which is the awkward thing to do in these matchups sometimes.
Another interesting thing, though, is, you know, your opponent has also sided out some of any of their creatures removal or whatnot. So, I mean, you do get a little bit of a clearer path.
Yeah, that is fair. There's still that mystic. There's still that Aethergust, which is one of like the answers to like multiple different permanents. Not only can you deal with Uro, you can also deal with Jor-El, you can deal with Wilderness Reclamation. Sometimes you can even protect yourself from Expansion Explosion. So Edergast definitely got a little bit better than what it used to be. It used to be a little bit awkward before M21 because, you know, especially if the game after sideboard used revolt around the Shark Typhoon tokens and, you know, Brazen Borrower, then that dispute sometimes, not dispute, then Edergast sometimes could get really awkward. But now with Jor-El in the mix, I think the card got a little bit better again.
This is interesting too, looking at Wolti's last couple of turns, you know, choosing not to play the Jor-El, I'm assuming because they want to use that Sublime Epiphany and stuck it kind of seven lands and really need to get to eight to be able to cast both of those.
This would also be a pretty sad Jor-El because you don't really have cards or additional cards that draw you more cards outside of that Sublime Epiphany. And yeah, I guess you're just waiting for like a better time to play it. On the other hand, you can still use the second ability from Jor-El to
absolutely
swing for lethal.
Yeah, that would have been, you know, a 6/6 and then a 7/7. So, you know, why not? A pair of them, actually. Though it's also been interesting playing on Arena because I think some people have not necessarily understood how Jor-El works a couple of times where they've attacked thinking it was lethal, that they were going to get +3/+3 for the three cards in their hand. And it's like, no, they're just three threes.
Yeah, Jor-El works really nicely with like Nissa or, you know, Hydrate Crisis or other cards with counters, where the counters obviously go on top of the base power and toughness. But yeah, if you're attacking with the 4/4 and you activate Jor-El with five cards in hand, it's just gonna turn into a 5/5.
I've sadly seen that more times than I can count already.
Jor-El also has to be in play for the trigger to happen when you draw the second card. So I also saw a lot of situations where one player had either Gust and they let the Jor-El player just resolve the second card draw, make a token, and then end of turn they would Gust the Jor-El, where you could just respond to the Growth Spiral or to the Opt or whatever it is that your opponent is using to draw their second card by playing Gust on the Jor-El, and that way they're not gonna make the free token.
All right, this little wolf has kind of gone the distance here.
Yeah, Kinnan getting flooded yet again with just so many lands and just nothing proactive. It's just all negates and disputes and, you know, 12 lands in play or something. And unfortunately for Kinnan, there is none of the flash threats. Like no Nightback Ambusher, no Shark Typhoon, which all those cards would have been absolutely amazing until now. Because, you know, those negates, they don't really do anything against the Ambusher, and like Sublime Epiphany could have gotten countered with a Mystical Dispute early on to force that Shark Typhoon token through. So now, fortunately for Kinnan, there's just all lands against, you know, this 2/2 token protected with a lot of counter spells.
Yeah, and look at how privileged a position Walty's in, where he didn't even want to fight over the Reclamation, even with extra mana up. He just said, fine,
yeah,
like, don't need it.
another negate. Oh, my God. And not even five cards in the graveyard for Uro.
Yeah, it's rough right now. And really, you're in a spot where you have to have an answer, and unfortunately, Walty's... When a Wolti hasn't cast anything in all this time, you're sitting across the table. You know that at least two of those are spell counters at this point.
Yeah, if you're Wolti, you're feeling pretty good about this spot. You can even discard the Jor-El. Yeah, I don't need this. I can just attack.
Yeah, I mean, you've got 9 mana. You've got 4 defensive cards in hand at the very least. Like, yeah, I mean, you just... Hang tight. I'm not sure what the opponent could even remotely come up with here.
Well, Kinnan really drew badly. Kind of this whole match.
Yeah.
Yeah, 13 lands in play. Oh my God. Not even drawing like Triomes or you know, even just Fabled Passages would be very helpful by letting you bring back Uro faster, which would have been really good against all these negates. But unfortunately for Kidna, this has been an awful draw.
This is an expansion for exactly two, it looks like. Negates. Didn't even fight over it. Just, just sure.
This is a really weird match. Like, no Shark Typhoon token got cycled in this game. It was literally just the 1-2-2 from Jolrael that just went all the distance. But obviously, we know that even if, you know, there were things involved, Wolti would have been very easily able to deal with all of them with all the counters in their hand.
All right. Well, having a mirror match to start with wasn't a surprise, but the first game seemed to be more interesting than that second one, unfortunately.
Yeah, hopefully we're going to get some non-growth spiral mirrors, you know, in the next couple of rounds, because I think we can reasonably expect more Temur, you know, down the road, especially because Luis as the end boss for today's tournament is also playing Temur Reclamation. You can see that he actually posted his list on Twitter. So if you guys are interested in that, he's actually splashing white. He's not just playing Temur. He's playing the four color Reclamation deck where there's like a little bit more triumphs to fix the mana, and then you're splashing Teferi to give yourself like a little bit of a trump for the mirror, where Teferi can just, you know, stop your opponent from being able to resolve their counter spells from using their Reclamation.
Well, looks like we're ready to go for another match here, so let's go ahead and hop right on into that.
All right, what do we have here? MrHadoken, I believe, is the previous winner of the CFB Pro Tournament. The first one, yeah, they won the first one. So already,
right, so we're going to be following MrHadoken here. We're going to be on the play with mono white. All right.
Wow, look at that. That's a really good curve too. Turn one.
Yeah,
giant killer.
I play a ton of aggro decks, and these are hands that always kind of scare you a little bit because you don't really want the four land hands, but you get the curve out and you kind of want to keep it because it's going to be a lot of damage over the first four turns. So you kind of get in a weird spot because if you do draw land at any point in these next three draws, it's going to get real rough.
Yeah, that's the downside of playing aggro. You know, whether it is mono green or mono white or mono red, mono black, Ragdoll Sacrifice, whatever it is, you are going to get screwed and flooded. That's just how it works. Like, you are going to get the bad draws and you're going to be forced to mulligan. And sometimes you're going to keep these. Like, this is a perfectly reasonable hand. It's actually a pretty great hand. You have a one drop, two drop into Glorious Anthem. But as you said, like, you're going to draw some extra lands. And at that point, those cards are going to be actual blanks because you can't do anything with, you know, six or seven mana. So you really need to hope that you draw non-land cards for pretty much the rest of the game. And especially in tournaments that are single elimination. So something like the CFB Pro Tournament, maybe the arena qualifier where you can only afford to have one or two losses. Mm-hmm. Maybe the Red Bull tournament where, you know, 7-1 usually makes the cut to day two, and then day two is also single elimination. In these tournaments, I think it makes a lot of sense to play a more consistent deck. So, you know, something like Ban, something like Temur Reclamation, you have a lot of card selection. You have all these scry lands and you have Opt. You're drawing a lot of extra cards between, you know, Growth Spiral, Uro, Teferi. You basically have so much card selection that it's really, really hard to get into these spots where you're either flooded or screwed, because in the Temur deck, even when you are flooded, you know, a third of your lands are, you know, Castle Vantress that you can use to scry to try to find more gas. You're playing 4-8 Triumphs, so you can cycle them to draw more cards. You know, Fabled Passage helps you bring back Uro from the graveyard. Blast Zone, you know, you can use that to destroy multiple one drops from your aggressive opponent or maybe deal with Teferi. So even getting flooded is really, really hard in these decks. Obviously, as we saw in the previous match, it can still happen, but that's just Magic. But you're much more likely to experience that when you're playing this kind of aggro deck. And it's unfortunate, but it's just going to happen. And for that reason, I think I prefer a lot to play some of these more consistent decks, because if you can only afford to have one loss, then, you know, avoiding that is a lot easier with with the more consistent decks. On the other hand, you know, sometimes you can find that one really good aggro deck for a specific tournament where maybe you are banking on people just not respecting aggro enough.
Sure.
Which I think right now it can happen with like a mono black deck that, you know, dodges either gust, same as the mono white deck, but mono black also has access to cards like Rotting Regisaur. And it's really, really hard for Temur to deal with Rotting Regisaur or even cards like Spawn of Mayhem sometimes, because they usually have cards like Flame Sweep or some of these, you know, cheaper burn spells like Scorching Dragonfire, you know, Bone Crusher Giant deals 2 damage. But try dealing with a 7/6. That's not so easy.
Yeah. And I think that's one of the things here. You know, even if Dark Hat or Dark Mat had actually had the removal, you do have like the Hollow Blade there that you could discard and keep in play. You know, you have another creature, when it dies, you're going to get a token. So even having the removal may not have been so strong against this particular draw.
Yeah, and this is the White Winnie deck just taking advantage of the fact that people are playing those either Gust's main deck now instead of, you know, those sometimes Storm's Wrath or Dragon's Fires. And yeah, this looks like it's going to be a pretty easy game one win for MrHadoken with that aggressive start.
Yeah, because I'm trying to think like what you could even do, but yeah, I was thinking at best you could leave some mana up to maybe draw a Brazen Bar, but even then you're at 3, so pretty tough.
Luckily for the White Winnie player, they end up on 4 lands by the end of the game. So all the draws since the game started have been on lands, which definitely helped. But also,
yeah, it helps when you draw business cards.
Yeah, you're also playing 21 lands, so you know, obviously you do have a higher chance of drawing a non-land, but that definitely did help. Looks like this list is really aggressive. There's 16 one drops.
Yeah, I dig it. I'm loving this. You know, you got a couple of the main deck unbreakable formations.
Glorious Anthem.
Yeah, there's a lot happening here.
Venerated Luxodon, yeah. Is White Winnie back? Is White Winnie great again?
This kind of speaks to what we were talking about with that first match, right? That a lot of these decks have moved away from playing Storm's Wrath main deck, you know, or even in the deck list at all in some cases. You know, we're not really playing that much spot removal anymore. And what you are playing is targeted for the red and the green decks. So if you can get in there, like you're saying, with mono black or mono white, well, maybe now's the time.
Yeah, this makes sense. Glorious Anthem, another new addition that obviously makes the cards like Raise the Alarm a lot better. You have a lot of cards that even survive these wrath effects. Haunted Witness and Garrison Cat, both leaving you with a token in play after they die. Yeah, I like that. I really like that Giant Killer is also an answer to a Shark Typhoon token or a Nightpack Ambusher. I think that's really important. Yeah, or an Uro. Yeah, I think that's really, really, really cool for the white deck.
So yeah, this would be interesting. Also cool that they, looking at it, they didn't bring in the Gideons, which I think they're just trying to stay on the most possible aggressive plan, you know, to get that damage in early before your opponent sticks the Wilderness Reclamation, really. Well, this looks like a selfless savior there with only a couple of spells, so that first hand had to go. We got Selfless Savior, Raise the Alarm. It looks like, what is that, a Garrison Cat? So like it's still an aggressive draw, but it's going to be probably a little more iffy trying to get there compared to the first game.
That's the downside. Yeah, if you mulligan, you're just stuck, you know, working with what you get, and there is no card selection. There's going to be no op. There's going to be no Scrylands to try to, you know, find what you need, and that's the advantage of playing Temur. Like sometimes you're going to mulligan, you know, you have to keep an awkward hand, but you can use that Scryland, you can use those off to try to find that turn to Growth Spiral, which is one of the best cards in the deck, to get ahead on mana, and then all your cards are becoming, you know, a little bit better, and that is definitely a slight advantage for the Temur deck as far as card selection goes.
So I do want to ask you something, because this has kind of been a debate between some of the deck builders and some of the more like casual to mid-level players. But when we talk about banning and restricting cards, one of the things I've been pushing for a while was like, let's get Growth Spiral on the list. Like, and I feel like that's one of the most powerful cards in the format right now. And it kind of feels like some people dismiss it because it's a common.
I agree. It's been too long of playing against turn two Growth Spiral. And normally we're used to, you know, standard being a format where things change every 3 months. But with so many cards getting banned from Ikoria and Throat of Eldraine, you know, all these Agent God Band, Fires of Invention, Once Upon a Time, Oko, like, I don't even know how many cards it is at this point. Basically, nothing kind of dethroned the Simic Ram deck from being the best deck in the format for what feels like almost a year now. So I think people, at this point, everybody's just sick of playing against that turn two Spiral, you know, get ahead on mana, play that Reclamation or whatever it is that I'm going to ramp into. And the biggest reason why Spiral is so good is that, you know, normally we're used to cards like Land of War Elf or Rampant Growth being in these slots where if you draw the card on turn 15, it's basically a blank. It's a dead draw. You know, Rampant Growth, when you already have 15 lands in place, not going to do anything. Sometimes you don't even have the basics in your deck anymore. So you're running the risk of, okay, if I draw, you know, Rampant Growth on turn 2, it's going to be great. If I draw it on turn 15, it's a dead draw. So I'm kind of just, you know, risking that happening. With Growth Spiral and Uro, you're just never unhappy to see any of these cards. And that just kind of makes your deck not really have any weakness, which I think is a pretty big deal, because previously these Ram decks, you know, sometimes you draw the wrong mix of spells and the wrong mix of Ram spells and payoff cards. Sometimes it's too many payoff cards, too few Ram spells, sometimes too many Ram spells. With Growth Spiral, this just never happens. And it's just, it's a common, but the card is so powerful, especially in combination with World Rest Reclamation and all these expensive cards.
Well, it looks like we have back-to-back turns of Loxodon followed by that Glorious Anthem there. So this is really putting the pressure on Dark Mat for sure.
I have to say, I'm impressed by the White Weenie deck.
We have a backup Raise the Alarm. So, like, this is looking good.
This is looking good, yeah. And, like, now having the Glorious Anthem means that two of these creatures are outside of the Flame Sweep range. So Flame Sweep doesn't even do anything. Like, you need to... Yeah, how do you even survive? Like, you can make a Shark Typhoon token to possibly block the Giant Killer, so you can't really afford to attack with the Giant Killer. Maybe draw, like... Yeah, I don't even know. You kind of need to get that. Yeah.
That's if MrHadoken even attacks with the Giant Killer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, being aware of the situation.
Yeah, I think it makes sense to leave it back because you can play around, you know, Nightback Ambusher. You can play around Shark Typhoon. So yeah, it does make sense.
Yeah, hey, this is a really, really tough spot for Dark Mat here.
I'm making notes because I really do think this White Weenie deck kind of makes sense. Obviously, I don't think it's going to be able to dethrone, you know, Temur from being number one deck in the format or anything. But a lot of the cards in the deck make sense. Seasoned Hollowblade, definitely a great addition from M21. I really like Loxodon as a card, just, you know, using that to make your one drops a lot better. Being not super resilient to the sweepers, but a little bit with the Hunted Witness and the Cat, you know, still leaving you with some creatures in play. Seasoned Hollowblade, you know, surviving the sweepers, and most importantly, the Giant Killer. It looks really, really good. Like it. If you leave it in your hand, you kind of get, you know, have this sort of protection from Nightback Ambusher or the Shark Typhoon or this Uro. If you put it in play, you can still use it to tap the creature. So yeah, it's looking really good, and it's putting the Temur deck under a lot of pressure, and they're forced to sort of play cards in a way that they don't want to. And yeah, it's been looking good for the White Weenie player.
And the Giant Killer does have reasonable value against the other aggro matchups as well. You know, we're talking about mono green, you can target almost all their stuff. You know, we're talking about even the red decks, when they get the big an axe or something else, like, you can just get rid of that. So it has a lot of action to that card. I really like it.
Yeah, I agree.
So trying to blow up a blast zone here. the Garrison Cat does leave behind a token. This Raise the Alarm is going to try to produce two more 2/2s.
Wow, that Raise the Alarm is brutal, because otherwise you would have been able to block with the Shark token on that Loxodon. That deals one damage to it. You take two from the leftover token and play. You would go to two, and then you could play Flame Sweep and copy it with expansion and actually just deal with the whole board, hopefully bring back Uro next turn, and all of a sudden you would be in the driver's seat. As it is now there's four threads that if two of them connect, you are kind of dead.
Oh.
So now it's a really awkward situation.
Unfortunately, this is a sorcery and not an instant, so you're going to get to respond with a Flame Sweep here.
But that also kills your Shark token.
Yeah.
So that was really good draw. Oh, wow.
That's a rough spot. That is a rough spot.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Needed one more land there off of that Uro, I think, is what we needed. So you could at least make a 1/1 off of the second Shark Typhoon in hand. Yep. Unfortunately, I think that's going to do it. Oh, no, because it's flying. It doesn't take damage from the
Flame Sweep. Oh, Flame Sweep. Oh, you're right. I completely forgot about that. I completely forgot about it. Yep.
Extra words on cards that rarely come into play, but sometimes they matter.
Okay, well, then everything changes.
Yep. Everything now changes. We're back to, I guess, making creatures off of the lands here, off of our castle. So we're going to cycle the Shark Typhoon for zero just to get a card there.
Yeah, now all you need to do is just point that explosion at the Loxodon if you want to get rid of it right away. Draw six cards in the process. You know, no problem. You can also put Uro in play, get yourself back to seven. Now you don't need to block the Loxodon. And yeah, at this point, it's very likely going to be smooth sailing for the Temur player with that explosion in hand and reclamation in play already.
For sure. I mean, I guess there's a few cards you could draw, like Vitus One, if they had sided those in.
Okay. I think starting with Giant Killer would be probably the best possible way. Just get that Uro out of here. Although, how much mana? 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. So almost actually able to kill that Loxodon.
Yeah, anyway.
But I think this is a safe spot to just draw yourself five cards. Just 0.5 at the opponent. Okay, looks like three is the number. Leaving two mana.
This is a less attractive spot for a Hollowblade. With no cards in hand. So setting up an attack, just going to let the opponent block with the Uro. Uro goes back to the yard.
And you're both happy and unhappy that this trade happened. Like, you're happy because you don't want to let your opponent attack with Uro and start gaining life and drawing cards. So in that case, you're kind of happy that Uro is off the table. On the other hand, you kind of just lost your only threat. So yeah, now your opponent has a full hand. They have all the mana in the world. They can play another expansion explosion. They can play that Bone Crush Giant, maybe try to bring back Uro yet again from the graveyard. So you know that at this point you're in trouble.
Yeah, now your opponent's life total is going the opposite direction. So you're now 10 to 17. And this is not where you want to be when you're on the aggro side.
Yeah, now the aggro deck doesn't have anything like Expansion Explosion. They don't have anything like Uro, and they're not drawing any extra cards. There's not even a Planeswalker, right? Is Basri in the deck? I didn't get to quite...
I didn't see Basri. I did see the two Gideons in the sideboard, but they did not get sided in.
Gideon is a really strong card. I like it a lot. I like it especially against these deck with these burn spells, and you can also tick it up really, really quickly, and then you can use it as a way to get rid of Reclamation, also get rid of Uro, or just destroy some some of these big reaches from your opponent. So I do like Gideon quite a bit, especially for a matchup like this, because that's, sometimes it's just impossible to deal with.
Yeah, so Liss doesn't have a Bossery in there. Like I said, there's the one Gideon in the sideboard. Actually, no, they did bring in one. There was two Gideons. One was in, one was out.
Okay. Bossery Solidarity is one of the cards that I would be looking at boarding out, because it's so bad against, you know, guys like Flame Sweep. I don't want to have these kind of situational enhancement effects, where obviously, at least if you have Glorious Anthem, it stays in play. So even if your creatures, you know, get killed, all the future ones are going to get bumped. But with cards like Bossery's Solidarity, it can get super awkward because it's a sorcery speed card to, you know, run that into a Flame Sweep or whatever. For that reason, I think I would also prefer having Unbreakable Formation over that, because it can sort of work as a sort of like a counter spell to something like Storm's Wrath or Flame Sweep.
I also personally would rather just have more threats, you know, so I would probably be looking to bring in that extra Gideon, which he left in the sideboard. You know, just yeah, you so yeah. If they do find a way to deal with two or three creatures, it's like you still have more behind it.
Yeah, and Gideon also works as an answer, kind of, right? If you have it in play for a while, it can also get rid of that row or Night Back Ambusher.
For sure. So this will be interesting to see how this plays out, because this like is much more, I guess I would say, more of an aggressive start than game two. This looks closer to game one, really, the way things kind of played out here. Though that being said, Dark Knight does have two Bonecrusher Giants, so those are definitely going to play a part here. But you're talking about playing them against creatures that one won't die, and another one's going to leave you a 1-1. So this would be interesting to see how this works out.
Yeah, those are really awkward targets for Bonecrusher Giant, but you're obviously happy to do it because you need to. Actually, do you even play Bonecrusher Giant? This is a really awkward spot. Because you don't have the third untapped land. If that Fabled Passage was anything else but a Fabled Passage, you'd be happy to you know, Bonecrusher, use that, play it as a 4/3 next turn, and, you know, have a blocker for that Haunted Witness, or just have a big creature in play. As it is, not having that third untapped land can get awkward. Maybe for that reason, you're going to be kind of forced to. Oh wait, you can't play Grossbar. Never mind. I didn't even look at the lands yet. There's a blast zone in play, so yeah. that growth spiral can't even get played.
This is kind of interesting on MrHadoken's side, because it looked like he was about to play the Raise the Alarm, and it looks like the plan was possibly going to be Raise the Alarm, Selfless Savior, and then get the Luxodon down. Mm-hmm. But then you do have the fear of getting hit by a Flame Sweep if that's sitting over there. But that being said, you would end up with a 1-1, you still have a 3-1, you still have a 4-4. Well, you'd have a 4-2, a 4-4, and I guess Selfless Savior could sacrifice and save something. So that's still not the worst thing, you know, even if you'd went forward with it.
Yeah, I think I kind of like it. I think it makes sense to go for it, because, yeah, as you said, you would still untap with like 10 power in play or something. It still makes sense to try.
It's kind of impressive. Yeah.
I like cards like Season Hollow Blade. I like Season Hollow Blade. I like slight misstep there, maybe a misclick by not attacking with the Haunted Witness, because obviously now you're not able to resolve that.
Yeah.
That already locks it on, but that was obviously just a misclick. And yeah, I like cards like Season Hollow Blade. Obviously, it does a really good impression of Edento Vanguard, which was one of the great ways how these aggro decks could put a lot of pressure on these decks with, you know, these burn spells or you know, cards like Shadow of the Sky. You can just keep protecting your guy by discarding cards from your hand or paying life for the Edento Vanguard. So I like when these cards exist so that you can kind of try to punish these you know, sweepers or burn removal spells.
How much respect is this, too, that Dark Matt brought in a Wilt?
Yeah, that probably also wouldn't be my first choice. Maybe the sideboard just, you know, doesn't add up for them, and they just kind of had to bring it in. You know, maybe they didn't want to they probably had a lot of counter spells in the main deck, maybe all those Mystical Disputes, Aether Gusts. I guess they just want to lower the curve a little bit and bring in something slightly better than Mystical Dispute.
Okay, so now this does matter if we're able to draw Flame Sweep here.
And again, then Bastard Solidarity in hand is just so awkward. Like, imagine if that was the unbreakable formation. You would be feeling super good, right? Like, okay, well, now I almost can't lose.
Yeah, because that would be, what, five? Well, I mean, if you do it as in response, you couldn't lose your board. So, yeah. All right, so a giant's going to come down. And, you know, you're looking at life total, it's 19 to 20, but we're going to be coming down real fast.
Yeah.
So we get to play the Selfless Savior here, which is going to protect whatever gets blocked by the giant, if necessary. And then you're going to get the Solidarity to put some counters on things. This is going to be a rough attack step here for Dark Mat.
You could put the extra counter on the Savior as well, or you could hold it in your hand so that you have like a way to protect the Seasoned Hollow Blade. But it's probably better to just do that by sacrificing the Savior from play rather than to hold it in your hand to be able to do the same thing. Now you have an extra 2/2 in play. Okay. Interesting situation. Now you can choose to even not seg the Savior. Might be better to just, you know, save that for like a Betty Theft or something, because you're still dealing lethal damage more than easily.
Yeah, that was kind of my question. I was just thinking, is like, do you even care at that point?
Yeah, at that point you just look at the opponent's list and see what you have to play around. But yeah, this was pretty impressive showing by the White Weenie deck. Yeah, this really aggressive.
You actually got 19 power in play too. So I mean, like, this is there's not a lot of answers for that when you're 5 life.
Yeah, these kind of decks were not great when Fires of Invention was one of the key cards in Standard, because, you know, Deafening Clarion was one of the most popular cards. And if your opponent has a 3 mana sweeper, it's really, really hard to be able to get them with these aggressive starts. Like, 3 mana sweeper is just way too cheap. And Clarion was exactly like the perfect card against you. Like, you don't have cards like Questing Beast, so your board would just always die. But now everybody's on Temur. Banned with maybe just 2 copies of Shadow of the Sky in the main deck. So yeah, I have to say, I was impressed by the White Weenie deck. That was good.
Well, MrHadoken continues his winning ways and gets into the next round. So that's pretty exciting. So yeah, we're going to go ahead and take one quick break here, and then we're going to come back with action on the other side.